Hello friends, I am Srishti and today we are going to cover next 5 questions of finance. So today's questions are really interesting because they relate to the static information you must know about finance. If you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, then do subscribe to it for more regular updates. Now starting with the first question for today. Now the question says, RBI has been reducing its repo rate to transmit the benefits to ultimate beneficiary in 2019. What will be the likely implication of the falling interest rates? So before discussing the answer, let's first try to understand the question. The question says that since 2019, as we all can see, that RBI is reducing its repo rate. And in the 5th bi-monthly policy also, it has reduced its repo rate so as to benefit the ultimate beneficiary to stimulate the economy. So with these falling interest rates, what will be the likely implication? Now here, assume that all the other factors which affects the inflation as well as the bond prices are constant. So we only have to focus that what will be the effect of the interest rates on these two factors. So let's understand it in the next slide. Now, as I have said that interest rates are falling, so what will be the effect on inflation as well as the bond price? Now, when the interest rates are falling, the inflation will go up. And how will this happen? As interest rates are lower, people will demand more loans. The demand for loanable funds will rise. People will borrow more. And as a result, the money supply in the economy will increase, which will directly increase the inflation in the economy. Now, you must relate it to the current scenario as well. Now, the inflation is below the target level, and that is why the Indian government is finding space and it is easier for the government to reduce the interest rates because the inflation is under control. Now, if we talk about the bond price, now as you know that the coupon rates on the bond prices are fixed. For example, there is a 10% coupon rate bond. Now assume the face value of this bond to be 100. So every month you are getting 10 rupees on this bond. Now suppose that the interest rates have gone down to suppose 8%. So everyone will find this bond offering 10% interest rate to be attractive and they will demand it so that the prices of these bonds will rise. So therefore the bond price will also rise. Now, as we all know that there is a relationship between bond price and bond yield. So although this is not a part of the answer, but still for your additional information, there is bond yield and that is interest upon the market price. So as we have seen that the market price is rising, so therefore the bond yield will fall. So with the decrease in the interest rates, what will be the effects? If we have to summarize this, the inflation will go up, bond price will go up, and thereby from the bond prices, the bond yield will go down. So coming back to the question, so as we have seen that with reducing interest rates, inflation and bond prices are likely to rise. So the answer is option A. Now let's see the other options also. With reducing interest rates, inflation remains constant and bond prices are likely to rise. This is not true. With reducing interest rates, there is no impact on the bond prices. This is also not true because we have seen that interest rates and bond prices have inverse relationship. Then the last option is with reducing interest rates, bond prices decline in line with the interest rates. So this is also not true. So the correct answer is option A. Now moving on to the next question for today. Now the question says, from the year 2017, which of the following survey is conducted by NSSO to provide quarterly employment and unemployment data? So 4 surveys have been given to you. Before answering the question, let's have some discussion on these surveys in the next slide. Starting with the employment and unemployment survey. So this is the quinquennial employment and unemployment survey. Now what does this mean? This means that the survey is conducted every 5 years. So this survey was conducted every 5 years, and it is a primary source of data on various indicators of the labor force at national and state levels. Basically, these are used for planning, policy formulation, decision support, and as input for further statistical exercises by various government organizations, academicians, researchers, etc. And it started in 1973. Now we have periodic labor force survey. Now the ministry has launched a new regular employment unemployment survey, namely periodic labor force survey, during April 2017, with certain changes in the survey methodology, data collection mechanism, and sampling design vis-a-vis the earlier quinquennial employment unemployment surveys. So this has been launched with an objective of measuring the quarterly changes of various labor market statistical indicators in urban areas, as well as generating annual estimates of these indicators both for rural and urban areas. So do note that it is a measure for the quarterly changes as well as generating the annual estimates of these indicators both for rural and urban areas. So an annual report on PLFS for July 2017 to June 2018 has been reported, and according to that, rural area men is at 5.8, rural area female is at 3.8, urban area men is at 7.1, and urban area female is at 10.8. Now moving on to the sample registration survey. So this is a large scale demographic survey for providing reliable annual estimates for the infant mortality, birth rate, death rate, and other fertility and mortality indicators. Now census, as we all know, that it is held every 10 years and it provides information on size, distribution, socioeconomic, demographic, and other characteristics of the country's population. So after discussing these, we have one thing very clear in our minds, that earlier EUS was there, but now PLFS has been launched in 2017 by introducing some of the changes in the survey methodology, data collection mechanism, and it is for quarterly as well as it generates the annual estimates, whereas EUS was held every 5 years. So moving back to the question to answer it. So the answer to this question is periodic labor force survey. As in the question, it is clearly mentioned the quarterly employment and unemployment data from the year 2017. Now moving on to the next question for today. A special project has been initiated for the public sector bank to deal with economically unviable projects. Under this project, the banks have signed an inter-creditor agreement which provides a framework to resolve assets through a bank-led resolution. So four projects have been given to you. Before answering the question, let's have a look at what these projects are there for in the next slide. So Project Shakti has been launched in 2001, and it is the initiative Project Shakti which helped HUL, Hindustan Unilever Limited, reach the so-called media dark regions by turning the rural women into direct-to-home distributors of its mass market products. So this initiative is aimed at the rural women to financially empower them and to create livelihood opportunities for them. In this regard, HUL has trained thousands of women in the villages across India to develop an entrepreneurial mindset and make them financially independent. And these women entrepreneurs are also known as Shakti Ammas, have been trained on basic tenets of distribution management and familiarization with the company's product. Next, we have Project Saksham. So Indian Railways has launched Project Saksham, country's largest time-bound upskilling exercise for its employees to boost their efficiency. So 13 lakh strong workforce is there, and the aim is to upgrade the skill sets of these workforce with a single drive spanning of 9 months. And it started in January 28 till September 2018. What is the need for this project? Indian Railways is constantly getting bad publicity on account of derailments, accidents, poor services, and inefficiency of its employees. So the mass killing exercise aims for the image makeover of Indian Railways by increasing the productivity and efficiency of its employees. Next, we have Project Shikhar. So under the Project Shikhar, SEBI is looking to redefine its vision, mission and value statements. And the last one is Project Sashakt. So this project is proposed by a panel led by PNB Chairman Sunil Mehta to address the bad loan problems in India's banking sector. So it is a five-pronged strategy to resolve the bad loans, with the larger ones going to an asset management company. So according to this Project Sashakt, for bad loans of 50 to 500 crore, banks will enter into an inter-creditor agreement authorizing the lead bank to implement a resolution plan in 180 days or refer the asset to NCLT. And for loans above 500 crore, the panel recommended an independent AMC supported by institutional funding through the AIF. AIF is Alternative Investment Fund. And what is the basic purpose and idea behind this? The idea is to help consolidate the stressed assets of the banks. So moving back to the question now. So the answer to this question is Project Sashakt, that is option D, as its aim is to address the bad loan problem in India's banking sector. An inter-creditor agreement is also there between the banks, wherein the lead bank will initiate the resolution plan. So this project is Project Sashakt. Now moving on to the next question for today. Which of the following institution has bagged the prestigious 14th BML Munjal Award for Business Excellence through Learning and Development for the year 2019 in the Public Sector Undertaking category? So understanding and learning more about BML Munjal Award, let's move on to the next slide. So let's first understand that what is the idea behind the awards. Now we all know that global boundaries are shrinking and competition is intensifying, and a complex transition is therefore taking place in the way organizations manage their human capital. So to effectively manage this transition, organizations are increasingly focusing on the capability building through learning and development in cross-functional areas of the business. So the annual BML Munjal Awards for Business Excellence through Learning and Development recognize organizations who have demonstrated the business excellence through innovations in learning and development. And they are awarded to companies that have consistently used training, learning and development as a source of competitive advantage. And the awards, they are named after the Hero Group Chairman and Padma Bhushan awardee, Dr. Brij Mohan Lal Munjal. Now there are five categories of the awards: public sector undertaking, private sector manufacturing, private sector the services one, then the emerging star and sustained excellence. So now let's discuss the winners for these categories. Private sector service, Tata Power, DDL. PSU is SIDBI. Emerging Star is Square Meal. Sustained Excellence is NTPC. And to Tata Consultancy Services as well. Then private sector manufacturing is Aurobindo. Now moving back to the question now. So the answer to this question is SIDBI, because we have been asked the winner for the public sector undertaking category. Now moving on to the last question for today. Time value of money supports the comparison of cash flows recorded at different time period by: first option is discounting all cash flows to a common point of time. Second is compounding all cash flows to a common point of time. Third is using either A or B. And fourth is none of the above. So as we all know, the time value of money is an important concept, because see, if you have 100 rupees today, so the value of this 100 rupees will not remain same after, suppose, 10 years. The value of this rupees 100 will fall. So therefore, you cannot comparison rupees 100 now and rupees 100 10 years after that. So time value of money concept is there to bring the cash flows of the project at a common time, so to have a clear comparison of those cash flows. So either the 100 rupees which you are receiving 10 years later, you can bring that 100 rupees to the present value now by discounting it, or you can either take this 100 rupees which you have today to a future value, that is after 10 years, what will be the value of this 100 rupees by compounding it. So the answer to this question is either by discounting or by compounding the cash flows to a common point of time, time value of money, it supports the comparison of the cash flows. So with this, we have completed 5 questions for today. I hope that you liked the session and you found the questions really interesting, which will benefit you in your examinations. If you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, then do subscribe to it for more regular updates. If you want other free materials as well, then do join our Telegram group for it. Thank you for watching the video.